Okay, we have more than 100 participants at the time and many are joining. Let me first introduce our eminent speaker, Professor Mahesh Tandon. And as a lot of people might already know who he is, since my duty, I will just introduce him. So Professor Mahesh Tandon is the Managing Director of Tandon Consultants Private Limited. He is an international expert in the field of structural engineering. Many of the structures that he has designed have been widely acclaimed and have received recognition in India and internationally. He is an international professional engineer certified in India. His professional contributions have been, he has spearheaded the development of new codes of practice and path-breaking bridge technologies suited to Indian conditions. He has done pioneering work in the field of segmental construction, integral construction, accelerated bridge construction, long span bridges, and structures for metro, both viaducts and underground. His structures have been described as highly creative, futuristic, aesthetic, environmentally sensitive, and innovative.
But you had a whole boy.
He has got many awards and honors for his great work. For example, he is the recipient of the Distinguished Alumnus Award of IIT Roorkee. He is also the recipient of the UKERI Award for Outstanding Concrete Technologies. He is an honorary fellow with the Indian Concrete Institute. He was also its past president, recipient of its Lifetime Achievement Award and Outstanding Concrete Technologies. He is a member of the National Committee of Civil Engineering, Institution of Engineers, past president, then in Indian Association of Structural Engineers, and also the president of the Indian Society for Wind Engineering. Under the AICT program, the Indian National Academy of Engineering had appointed him as a distinguished visiting professor at IITs Kanpur, Roorkee, and Gandhinagar, and currently he is also continuing as the guest professor at IIT Gandhinagar. His ongoing impetus, he's made a significant contributions in the development of a culture of innovation in structural engineering, both within the outside of his organization by sharing his expertise and experience. He is now here today to share his special areas of interest and to motivate the next generation to adopt civil engineering as their profession and vocation in life. With this great but brief introduction, I welcome Professor Mahesh Tandon for today's session. I request our president of IAS Rakti, Mr. Alok Bhaumik, to say a few words for this webinar.
Thanks. Thanks very much, Dr. Anand Sheth, for your welcome address and introduction of one of our most favorite speaker, Professor Mahesh Tandon. I mean, it is indeed a proud privilege for me to get the opportunity to listen. I mean, as many a time inside, and particularly the subject that he has chosen. I will not be standing between the participants and Professor Mahesh Tandon for long. I am here essentially to express my gratitude to one and all, you know, in our career for making this webinar a grand success. I sincerely thank Dr. Anandji, you and your team of the Secretariat for putting up these series of webinars one after the other. We have already organized, I think, six webinar so far, and this is seventh in the series. We are going to have one more on 27th, we have one more on 28th, and in June also, July also, we are I think organizing at least three more webinars. So it is a great show, and I thank you very much for this, because I know that under the best of circumstances also it would have been difficult and challenging task to organize such webinars, and particularly to do the same in this kind of difficult circumstances, much more challenging. My special thanks to Professor Tandon for sparing his valuable time today with us and for sharing his knowledge. I know how busy he is. I'm interacting with him in many platforms, but at the same time, I know that he never disappoints us in IASTRACTI. Whenever we have made requests to him, he has always obliged, leaving aside all other works. I also thank all the participants who are taking keen interest in these webinars and building their knowledge base. Today, I think we are going to see more than 500, I guess. As of now, I see about 220 participants, but I'm sure this number is going to increase. It shows that our webinars are serving the purpose and the objective of our association. With this, I would hand over the floor to Professor Mahesh Tandon. Sir.
Okay. Thank you very much, President Alok Bhaumik, and thank you very much, Dr. Anil Sheth, for your kind introduction. So the subject you already know, so we will proceed ahead. So first we will talk about segmental construction, a technology which we all know. I think this must be a very familiar sight to many of you, although this angle may have been new, because these days with the advent of the aerial photography which is possible by drones, you can see your structure which you have never seen before. So metros are really the new travel mode, and we have done quite a lot of work in India, and many of us have become specialists in the design of segmental constructions, which is the technology used for metro viaducts. This must be a familiar sight to all of us, and wherever we go now and then, we always encounter the ground level view of the segmental construction. You can see these lines, they are about 3 meters apart, and this constitutes one segment. And the whole structure is supported on a pier which occupies about 2 meters on the central verge. We don't have more space than that in the on the ground level. So this is become the norm, I would say, for segmental construction of metro bridges. How do these things work? Because there is no reinforcement. As you can see in these vertical lines, there is no reinforcement in the shear keys, and there is no reinforcement which projects out. So how is the load transfer that takes place? The slip, the secret is really in this pre-stressing force. As you can see in this slide, which shows you the ultimate failure, how it would happen. And these are the cracks which would develop in the ultimate failure. It is really the pre-stressing force combined with the shear keys that enables the shear to be transferred from one segment to another. So the whole span is stable, and there are no failures, only because we have a pre-stressing force apart from shear keys, which you can see here. So these shear keys are exact fits, which means that they are match cast. Here you can see the molds for match casting. You see one segment which has been made here, constructed here. The next segment will be cast against this face, so that the corresponding face will be an exact mirror image of what you see here. Even if you were to do machining by any means, you will not get the same accuracy of fitting the two segments as you would if you cast the next segment against it. So after the segments are cast, they are stacked together, as you can see here, this is a whole lot of segments which are lying here in the stacking yard, while the foundations and the substructure are going on at the site. This is already positioned here. The next step would be to put these segments one by one on a trailer, which can be as big as this, as you can see. As per the IRC 6, you can have even a 385-ton trailer, which can got 20 axles, even such a big segment. And these days, there are bridges which are huge in size. The metro is only 10 meters wide, but you've got even 32 meters, 34 meters. That's what people are attempting now. So those segment transportations would look like that. The way the segments are cast, in the same sequence, you have to erect them so that the match cast face is always against each other. The segments are brought to the site by what is called a low-bedded trailer. Low-bedded trailer means that the center of gravity of whatever you are transporting is low enough so that when you take turns, etc., there is no overturning effect. The way it is done is that you bring the segment directly below the point where you have to erect it. What you see in red color is called the erection truss. So all the segments are lifted up one by one, and then they are pre-stressed. These holes that you see, this is where the threading of pre-stressing cables will be done, and then you stress it when all the segments are dry matched, and you put epoxy in this joint and you pre-stress it. At that time, the whole span can be brought down to the bearings. This is where the bearings are located for this particular span. One of the disadvantages of this is that you are bringing the segments on city roads, which is always a problem. There are many countries across the world which are no longer permitting this. They are saying that you do all the transportation on the already constructed portion. That means the segment will be brought from here on top of the already constructed portion and erected, not using the city roads at all. The next technique which I want to talk about is the free cantilevering technique. Here you can see what free cantilevering means. Free means that there is no support from the ground. You are using the already constructed portion to construct the next segment. When you have a cast in situ segment, the erection equipment is fairly simple, as you can see. And so you can meet in the center here, and here you can at least go up to the mid span so that it's completely balanced. But the side spans are always shorter than the main span. The ideal ratio is about two-thirds and of the main span, as you can see in this best span arrangement written here. Now the question is that after you reach here, then what is to be done? People are often putting ground supported staging here to be able to cast the remaining part of the span, which means that 50% of it has already come here, but the remaining, how to do it. So this is something which we have done in the past, and it is now going to be used in some of the Delhi Metro projects, where you support a truss on the pier cap and on the edge of the cantilever, which you have already constructed, which is balanced. And then you cast it in situ. You can also do it this by precast segments, but anyway, this photograph shows you it as to how it can be done in cast in situ. So the thing for precast segmental construction, another thing that has been developed is that without using the city roads, how to construct these cantilevers across? You don't always have to bring the segments from below. You can bring the segment as these arrows show from the end side, which is more easily accessible. And by this equipment, you can transfer the segment longitudinally and then lower it in position. This is quite a novel technique for making precast segmental construction in cantilever bridges, where you don't want to disturb the city roads. Here it is a railway track, and obviously you can't disturb the railway track. So here again, the segment is brought from the end and then lifted and longitudinally moved and then lowered down into position. And then of course you have to do some pre-stressing to attach this segment to the already constructed portion. This is another fascinating project which has just been completed. It is the metro bridge at Ernakulam station. And as you can see, it is going over railway tracks, plenty of them. These things that you see at the bottom, these are all trains. They are not toys. They look like toys, but they are actually real trains. And it is going over a very heavily crowded area. And there is a flyover, which is just here. So what has to be done now is that, if I can just show you. If you can see this, this structure has to be extended right in this direction. And so part of it will be overhanging on top of the flyover. And that is what you can see in this slide, where you can see the flyover. And the next part of it, incidentally, is in steel. This is the steel part of the bridge, which you can see here. And that is partly hanging over the flyover, which you can see here. So all this is possible when you are using cantilever construction techniques. And here is another one where you can see at the center how the cantilever construction will meet at the center, and then the bridge will be complete. This is another bridge which is in Bhutan on the Punat Sangchu River, and you can see that from the two banks the cantilevers are coming and they will meet in the center. This is the completed bridge, and these are fast flowing rivers. There is no question of putting any supports from the bottom. It has to be done from there. Of course, the other parts when you are building bridges in such terrain is that there is no room on the sides either. You bring enough material only to cast the segments which are there. It is not possible to do precast segmental construction in these type of situations because there is no place to even stack materials on the sides. So you bring enough material which can be done for the day or for that segment, and then you have to keep on constructing, cantilevering from both sides. Another example of cantilever construction is when you are making these metro structures over already existing flyovers, or even when you're making flyovers over already existing flyovers or metro structures, then this is the way you do it. As you can see, this is a three span construction. This is the side span. This is the main span. And then you have another side span. And this is an existing flyover. Here you can see that you have actually met at the span on top of the bridge, and you are not disturbing any traffic, except that you should not permit any traffic when any construction is going on at the top. So obviously you should do all the concreting at night, not during the day. And you should close the flyover during that period. These are some safety precautions which must be taken when you are when you are going underneath something which is already under construction. Full span construction is another area of interest. This is something where a 40 meter spliced girder, spliced means that it was 20 meters long and there are two pieces and they have been spliced, as you can see here, before they are erected in position by two cranes. This is again become a common way of erecting these long full span girders. Here you can see the full span girder is being brought into position, but when you are making a 40 meter span girder, it is not possible to transport 40 meters unless you are very lucky and the transportation is possible. Most of the time it is not possible, so you do it in two pieces and then you pre-stress the two together and splice it and then erect it in one piece as is shown in here. Of course, here you can see the finish that you can get in a precast, pre-tensioned girders, how neat these lines, etc. are. And of course, somebody did ring up from Gurgaon and said that, how is it that you forgot to put a pier here? Why is it hanging out? I mean, the problem in this case was that the height of the, as you know, you have to have a minimum height clearance here. And you also have to have some limit of the height of the full structure, because this is just next to the airport. So the only way to do that was not to extend this pier cap up to here, but use the diaphragm, which you can see here, which is joining all the precast girders, and then hang the girder from there. This is where the load of the girder is transferred, and this part of the diaphragm is behaving like a cantilever, the last bearing being here just underneath this girder. This is another example of full span construction box girder. That was a simple eye girder, but you can have box girders. As you can see here, the girder is brought into position. This is a launching truss which has got these arrangements for hanging on both sides, and it lifts up the girder and takes it into position, and then it is lowered as is shown in this slide. So this has also become now full span construction. You see, why we are using full span construction is that any construction joint that you put, or any joint that you put in concrete, is, you may do anything, but it is a point of weakness which you are introducing. A monolithic construction, if you have, is better than a some construction in which you have put a joint. So this is what I think the future is, that you have a full span construction, and the challenge is how to put it in position. Of course, you can see here something which weighs about 650 tons. This is also for the high speed train in Taiwan. And you can see how the full span is being erected into position by this launching truss. Now, some bridges have been constructed by rotation, and this is a technique which has not been used enough. I will show you how this is, some examples. This is where the bridge is constructed. As you can see here, the ground supported staging has been put here, and this whole superstructure was erected here. And then it was rotated into position, as you can see here. This is, of course, the final view. And the original location was somewhere here of the bridge. and it is the whole thing is rotated, as you can see here, there's some mechanical bearings and stuff like that is required, but the support should be capable of taking the vertical loads and also possible to rotate it without difficulty. So this is something which has not been used frequent enough, according to me. Maybe our canals, we don't have these small canals. We always have large rivers where, of course, this technique would be difficult to apply. But I think when you do get a small canal structure like you have in Ahmedabad, the Sabarmati River itself has been narrowed down. Now, in those type of situations, I think this technique would work very well. This is another way of making an arch where you don't put any staging from the ground, but you construct it vertically, as you can see here. You prop it, you make a support it with a cable, and then gradually lower it into position. The two halves of the arch bridge are lowered into position, and this is how the arches can be made. This is another technique which I think has not been used enough, and I think there is some future in it. Here is a picture of the two halves of the arch which are being lowered into position, and if you can see carefully, this is the these are the cables by which the half arch will be lowered. Bridges constructed by pushing is another technique, again, I think not utilized enough as yet. Although this was perhaps the earliest techniques that the railway bridges were made in steel. Let's see how they were made. This, of course, is a more recent project on Metro's Line 3, but the whole steel structure is actually constructed on outside the railway tracks, which you can see here. You have to get permission if you want to support anywhere in between. For example, here you got another support. So after you have assembled the entire steel structure, you push it forward and you have supports, of course, wherever they are necessary, and you reach the other end. So this is all, again, a very fascinating technique which has been there for a long period of time, and the old railway bridges were always constructed in this fashion, or at least many of them. This is again something which is not in steel but in concrete. This little shed that you see at the end, this is where the whole bridge was cast, not in one length but in half the span lengths. That is all, that is the length of the bridge. So you keep casting behind and keep pre-stressing. After you have pre-stressed it and made it a part of the main bridge, then you push this whole thing forward, and you can see this nose which is there. This nose is necessary because really before you reach the next pier, you will have a tremendous cantilever bending moment which will happen, which may be four times the bending moment that it's supposed to carry during service stages. So you don't want to design a bridge which is only for, which is dimensioned by the temporary stages. So that is why this light nose is necessary, so that you can reach the next span quickly and without too much of load. And then later on, of course, after the bridge has reached the other end, steel nose is removed. Another bridge that I want to talk about, and this engineer, structural, he's a master designer of today. All the major bridges, there is invariably, you will see this name, complex to pronounce, Monsieur Verloger, but he's a Frenchman. And this is one of his creations, which was very interesting to see. And on the at the opening ceremony of the bridge, the Prime Minister said that this is this bridge has the delicacy of a butterfly and it floats on the clouds. The French are always use a very flowery language about what they appreciate, and I think this is what was these were the words used by the Prime Minister. But certainly it is one of the most breathtaking bridges ever built. That I think there is no doubt. Again, Mr. Varloje, as you can see, this is how it was constructed. It was pushed into position. That means that the bridge was actually built on the two banks and then pushed into position till you reach the center. So even cable stayed bridges, which are quite big spans. For example, here you have a span of 342 meters. Of course, there is a temporary tower which they have made in order that the cantilever does not become too long. Sorry. So this is something again which is pushing techniques which we have to use, and they are going to be used more and more in the future. It is a question of having the right type of equipment, which may be a little costly, the equipment part, but I think that now the balance is moving towards spending more money on construction equipment and less on labor. Here you can see the bridge being during construction, it is being pushed into position, and these are temporary cables. The real cables will be put later on. What you saw in this slide, these cables are the permanent cables which have put into position later on. Arch is always been the favorite form of the structural engineers, and here is what you can see. This is one of the early bridges which was made. It is called the Dodan Nala Bridge. The reason being that there was a lot of accidents on this road, which was the original bridge, and the government decided to make another bridge which does not have this sharp blind curve at all. So they made this bridge, but obviously because the bridge was quite aesthetic in looks, the buses are still coming here and they stop here, and the passengers get down, have their lunch or whatever, and admire the bridge, and then they get onto the bus and go away. I think that this is perhaps the most laudable comment one can receive from the public, where people are willing to go on the bridge, spend some time, and this is the only place where you can really see the bridge. If you are just passing on it, you will not see the beauty of the bridge. But the way it was made, since it was constructed long time ago, is that there was scaffolding, as you can see here, and some of the supports were also in the river. But this is not the way to make the bridges, the arch bridges now. You have already seen one technique, which is constructing halves of the bridge and vertically and lowering them. There are other ways of making this bridge. This is the more recent one in Himachal Pradesh on Parvati River. As you can see here, the two cantilevers are coming from both the edges, and every time you cast a segment, you have temporary towers and cables which support you temporarily. So till you reach the center, you keep on growing. As you can see here, there are two levels at which these cables are there, and you have a tall tower, and from two places the cables are starting, and then holding on temporarily the structure till the arch is complete. Once the arch is complete, it is stable by itself, and then you can remove all these temporary features. And this is what the bridge looks like in real life. Another fascinating thing that was done here is that the bridge deck was constructed by suspending the shuttering of these beams and the deck slab from the truss itself. So once you have made the from the arch itself, from once you made the arch, you can make the deck quite easily. So this is another way in which you can construct, and I think this is another. But now this technique that you see, which is making use of temporary towers and cable stays for making arch bridges, has become the norm. Here is another one, which is the railway bridge at Rajahmundry, which is again a fairly good span, 97.6 meter, which is a good span for railways. And you can see how the arches are being constructed by putting temporary towers and stay cables so that you can reach the tower. Once, of course, the arch is complete, then you can lower down and remove all the temporary works. This is another bridge in France, which I think deserves to be seen, which again, we have not used this possibility in the future. Of course, the arch can be made in the techniques which we have already discussed. But the fascinating part is that if you use a shallow arch, which as is done here, you can put the staircase to for pedestrians to cross on the arch itself, instead of putting it on the deck, which, you know, you inhale all those fumes of the cars which are rushing past. It will be much better to put the staircase here so that people can admire the waterway and also cross the bridge as pedestrians would like to. Here is another bridge which is in steel, and this I think is the world record at the moment, steel arch bridge. It is, you can see, it is made of a number of members, and both the arches and the deck, as you can see, are being constructed simultaneously. This is a truss bridge, and you don't have to complete the arch before you start constructing the deck. To save time, you can do both the constructions simultaneously. Of course, you can see the same technique. You have the temporary tower and you have the stay cables. That is how you construct the arch. And of course, the stay cables and the deck, you can keep on supporting. As you keep on growing, you can support the each truss or deck segment that you make here. You can support it by hangers from the top, and these can be the permanent hangers of the bridge. So this is another technique which I think has certainly, we can call it as the one of the recent advances in arch bridge construction. There are many bridges which have been constructed by mixing the techniques which we have already discussed. Of course, I have discussed only some of the techniques by which bridges can be constructed. That is not all the techniques, but I have given you a bird's eye view about what techniques can be used, and mixing techniques as well as materials. When you say materials, I mean concrete and steel. By mixing them, and also by the techniques. This is again one of the most beautiful arch bridges which have been constructed, and the beauty comes because this is just a single beam that you see here. There is no portion here at all, no supports here. And how this was constructed is that the arch itself was constructed by the techniques which we have already discussed. And you have got the deck, which is also constructed by using cantilever construction techniques. You construct by cantilever from here and from here, and you meet here. And the arch bridge, of course, is constructed by the techniques which we have already discussed. I will show you another technique. And like I said, somebody has said that it is impossible to photograph this bridge from a bad angle. Here you can see the arch being constructed in segments, and you can see the stay cables which are holding up. As you keep on adding segments, you are holding on to them by temporary stays, and this is something which is a spandrel. This is the only column that exists. There are no spandrel columns or anything in this part. So the permanent part of the structure was used for hanging the construction of the arch segments. Previously, what you have seen is that you have temporary columns and trestles, etc., which go up. But sometimes you can use the permanent structure itself to hold the segments of the arch. Here you can see the arch being in segments, and here you can see the cantilever construction which is going to be made to make the deck. So the deck and the arches again can be made simultaneously if you want. Here you can see another view of the same thing. You can see this is the permanent part of the bridge, the only columns that exist, and we are using those to be able to construct the arch. And the final view, of course, is something fascinating. And this is because it is something totally new. People thought that the deck has to be supported by some spandrels or beams or any columns or something which are supported on the arch or something. This is completely without it. And I think that is what is the novelty of this bridge. Another thing that has come up in as far as this mixed construction is concerned is concrete filled steel tubes. This is the world record at the moment, some 616 meters. The arch, of course, you know now the standard way of constructing, and I will show you photographs of that, which means that you have a temporary tower and you have a number of stays, and that is how you complete the arch bridge. But this one, again, you should do it by cantilever construction from both the sides and use the permanent hangers of the deck to be able to do progressive construction. Here you can see the arches are being constructed, same temporary tower, and you have the stay cables. So it is both the cantilevers are being advanced till you meet at the center. And once you do, then that will be the arch will be complete, and it will be self-supporting, and you can remove everything that you want. Now, the new part of this is that it is a concrete filled tube. That means that to start with, it is very light. It is a hollow section of steel which you have used for all this. And then you have concrete pumps, which you can see here, from which you put high pressure grouting, so that this entire bridge, which is originally a hollow steel tube, can be made into a concrete structure. So the steel will also be there taking part of the load, and part of the load will be taken by the concrete. So this is another technique which is of more recent origin. Here you can see again how it was made. The cantilever construction is going on from both the ends, and you can see they are using a ropeway in order to be able to transfer these segments so that they can be attached to the already constructed portion. So this concrete filled steel tubes is another thing of the future. Or not future, but it is the present, let us say. We are talking about the present advances. And here you can see how the deck is being constructed in cantilever using the permanent hangers of the deck. So it's a technique which I think deserves to be acknowledged, that it is certainly something new. This is the old bridge which from where it all started. Using the permanent part of the bridge to make to do the cantilever construction of the arches. That is the first thing that was done in this bridge. The other is that the deck is made now by push launching, as you can see here with the steel nose in front. So it's this is a fascinating example, a classic example, how an arch bridge can be constructed using the permanent parts of the structure, not a temporary tower or anything, using stay cables, and then using the deck by some other technique altogether. So this is what the mixed construction is now coming to. This is the Normandy Bridge, and you see the, again the familiar name of Monsieur Verloger of France, and this was his conception and his design. What he did was that he made the central part of this world record span at that stage in steel. So the central part about from here to here is in steel, and it is the steel also is comes in segments, and the segments are brought in the by river and lifted in position. The span was required because only at this point you see some water which is here. Here, of course, there is no water at all. Here, the it is of a shallow depth, and so there is no chance of anybody, any boat hitting against it, or any barge impact for which you have to design. Because barge impact is one of the major issues which comes into the picture when you are making something in the river, and some supports which come inside the river are always in danger. These short spans that you see are extremely valuable. Not only this is where the incidentally the push launched bridge is, and after it has come here, only then you start making the stay cables, and as you will, I will show you in the next slide. But this is extremely necessary, not necessary, but extremely helpful. If you don't require a side span, then you should, which is large, then you should make small span, because this what happens is that you are in a way making this part of the bridge much more stiff. If I put a load here, if you have a short spans here, this is like more or less a fixed end. So the bridge cannot deflect, for example, in this fashion. It cannot, because you have pinned it down here. So this is another, I think, important feature of design, which must be kept in mind, that you should not make side spans large when they are not necessary. You can make short spans and they will help you a lot. Normally, the design of this main span is governed by deflections, and if you can somehow reduce the deflections, you will be doing a much more economical design, and that is what has been done here. Here you can see the construction methodology. You have this push launching, which has been made, and you have simultaneously one span has been is cantilever construction. And after you have reached some stage, then you start the steel bridge construction. The steel are also in segments, just like the concrete segments which you have seen already, precast segments. You have steel segment, which are each segment is attached, and then you keep on growing till you meet the center. Now people are not satisfied with this, you know, under 1 kilometer type of length. Although the tallest building at the moment, which is not completed yet, is going to be 1 kilometer, but as far as the bridges are concerned, I think we crossed the 1 kilometer span quite a few years ago, and I will show you some of the things which are happening now. Starting with how man's desire for long span bridges is not new. This is a drawing which is 1595, made in one of these Italian publications, where they have made use of stay cables, but these are made from steel chains. Here you can see. And of course, they've got very strong abutments. They never thought of putting another span or another stay on this side. But when you go to even an older bridge, and I think this is something which we should be proud of, which was constructed in Tibet, in something like the earliest known suspension bridge in the world. This is something like 1435. This is from a sketch which was made, and there is in 1867, there is a reference to it by when they were doing this. I hope you know the great trigonometrical survey, where the leader of the expedition was Engineer Everest. He did such a fantastic job. In those days, they knew how to honor their engineers. They named the world's highest peak in his name, and this is Everest. And he did this trigonometrical survey. There were no fancy satellites and all and total station surveys to help them, but when they finished the trigonometrical survey and at the closure, it was within feet. That means 2-3 feet was all the distance. The distance by which it was off, which I think even today, I mean, imagine doing the whole country and making this trigonometrical survey to that accuracy with the equipments that they had at that time. I think it is something absolutely fascinating. So when they were doing this trigonometrical survey, they were also doing other things. Like, for example, they were looking at what is the culture of the place, what is in the wherever they were going, and making notes of it. And there is a fascinating book. I wish you could. This is available free on the internet. Report on the Trans-Himalayan Explorations in connection with the Great Trigonometrical Survey of India during 1865-67. And like I said, Engineer Everest was the leader of that expedition, or leader of the engineer group. Here you can see there is a suggestion of a backstay which has been made. So there is not only a cable which is the main hanging cable, and the hanging cables also, you see how beautifully they have done. This is where the main cable is. This is a section which is taken here, and there is also, they have hung the deck here. So this is the one of the earliest known suspension bridges in the world. So it is, I don't know whether it still exists or not, but in 1865, it still existed. After this, there were another bridge, which was called the Menai Suspension Bridge. And it was designed by Thomas Telford. You must have heard this name. Now they have a publishing house in his name. He was one of the greatest British engineers who in somewhere in 1819, can you imagine, he made a span of the total length, 176 meters. This is a 176 meter span in the year 1819. Can you imagine? And at that time, when Thomas Telford was designing and constructing this bridge, there was also talk about the durability considerations for materials which were being debated. And Lewis Carroll, the famous author, the children's most favorite author, who wrote Alice in Wonderland, he suggested in his very literary language that to prevent it from rust, it should be boiled in wine. And the exact wording in one of his books of Lewis Carroll, he says, I heard him then, for I had just completed my design, to keep the Menai Bridge from rust by boiling it in wine. Now, the more recent things that we are seeing is suspension bridges and cable stayed bridges. I will not talk about extra dose bridges, which is somewhere, you know, even smaller than that, because we've already crossed that landmark as far as long span bridges are concerned. But here you can see when you have a deck, the biggest problem of suspension bridges is the wind effects which you have to encounter. The aerodynamic forces acting on the bridge are functions of both the incoming turbulence and of the bridge motion. This is where it starts becoming dangerous. That means that when the two start interacting, you have the wind blowing, and of course there is turbulence in the wind, and there is a motion of the structure. When both of them combine and one feeds on to the other, that's when you start getting problems. Basically, what you have is, if you take a structure, a cross section, you have the drag coefficient, which means parallel to the wind direction. You have a lift coefficient, which is perpendicular to the lift, and you have a torsion, which means you have a moment across this, the cross section. So these are basically the three types of actions, which is structural actions, which take place, and they don't act independently. They can act together, and the problem is that when they start acting together, and if you have a very slim structure, then you can have big problems. So how did we learn about aerodynamics? There was the famous Trachoma Narrows Bridge in Washington State in USA, which was constructed in 1940. And it was opened to public on 1st July, and it collapsed on 7th November, which means 4 months and a few days. During, that is all. And it collapsed during mild wind. Now, this is because of the flutter phenomena. Flutter, as I've already told you, is something where the wind motion and the motion of the structure, when the two start feeding into each other, that's when you have the flutter phenomena. And that's what you have to prevent. And of course, there are many reasons people are still discussing why the bridge collapsed. And you can see the bridge in the state of collapse. The whole thing is, you know, there is a big torsion that you see here. As a matter of fact, there were 2.5 cycles of torsion which existed here, apart from the up and down motion. The section of the bridge was like this, what you can see here. There were the two fairly big and solid ends, which you are seeing here. And you had the deck, which is located here. Now, this is not a very good section to have, because firstly, it doesn't have a good torsional resistance. And so we learned a lot from them. After that, what happened was that instead of using a section like that, they started also putting a stiffening truss below, which you can see here. So the many bridges which were constructed after this, the suspension bridges always had this stiffening truss. And the whole generation of bridges, maybe for 50 years were built, or 60 years, they were built with a stiffening truss. Many of the great bridges you may have heard of, this is the existing world record, although it was constructed more than 20 years ago. It's a little short of 2 kilometers is the span. And there are many other great East Belt, Humber Bridge in UK, and the Verrazano Narrows Bridge. You also have the Golden Gate Bridge. This bridge, why it is still a wonder, is that in 1937 they made a span of 1.3 kilometers. Even today we have reached only a little short of 2 kilometers. It is not something which is some order of difference. It's very close to that. And in those times, most of these major bridges were made in the USA, but there are some bridges in Europe also, like the Tagus Bridge in Portugal, which is also very famous. As you can see here, this is the magnificence of the Akashi Kaikyo Bridge, the world record at 1,991 meter. Incidentally, during an earthquake when it was under construction, only the towers were constructed, and towers by themselves are just cantilevers, and they shifted by 1.5 meter at the top. And although this was 1.5 meters, they redesigned the structure, whatever little fine tuning that had to be done, and it is still out of plumb. If you want to see the way things are going, I mean, there was suddenly, of course, a big jump, and now there are still big jumps happening over the years. Where this is going, we are not sure, but there is now another book which you must take out. This is again freely available on the internet. It talks about the superstructure of bridges by Chinese sounding name Wai Fai Chen or something like that, and it is tells you what is the limit to which you can reach in various types of bridge construction techniques. Now we talked about the stiffening. We were first had this in the Tacoma Narrows Bridge, which collapsed. Then we used the stiffening truss for a number of years, and by chance, this bridge was constructed. It is the Severn Suspension Bridge, constructed in 1966, which is a streamlined box. This was discovered accidentally, not discovered, but put in place accidentally. There were two engineers who were working with the designers, and they were given the task. The original design was the stiffening truss, and they were supposed to do the wind tunnel testing. And when they got the model to the wind tunnel test site, they unfortunately accidentally broke it. Then these two engineers, they were always worried about and interested in this wind tunnel effects. They said, why don't we put our own model and see how it behaves? And their model was something similar to this picture that you see. This is, of course, the real Severn Bridge, but it was very similar. And they found that you don't require the stiffening truss, actually. What you need is to reduce the demand on the structure of the wind effects. If you can reduce the wind effects, there is no need to stiffen it. And that is what was done. And even today, you will see that these are the type of sections that people are using for long span bridges. Another development which took place in not very long ago, and which is now being explored even further, is that you have a streamlined shape, but in the streamlined shape you put a gap in between so that you don't have such a long expanse of the bridge of the cross section on which the wind the dynamic effects of wind can affect. Now it can affect only this much, because at this place the wind will again whatever is coming from the top and from the bottom, it will more or less neutralize. So the wind effects are not on a very large part of the deck. So this is, I think, a great, I would say, discovery or invention, whatever you want to call it, of the aerodynamic stability, how it can be made by making it in two parts, your deck. This is for the up and down traffic. Of course, these days people are not happy with whatever they have. This is what the Stone Cutters Bridge in Hong Kong, which was at one time one of the longest cable stayed bridges in the world. But now what is happening is that people are trying to do it with two gaps. You see this? This is a very strong, what is in blue is a strong diaphragm in steel, and you've got three parts of the deck. You have the up and down traffic, and you have the metro in the center. So this is another development. You see, people have always used, or I would say, stood on the shoulders of the previous inventions or inventors and produced something which is a slight modification but a great improvement. Now this, you can say, is a slight modification of what you are seeing at the top, but it's a great achievement because now people are talking about a span of 3.5 kilometers. At the moment, we are at 2 kilometers, and this Messina Bridge, number of proposals have been made. Nothing has been constructed so far, but people are already talking about 3.2 kilometers. Another thing which I want to talk about is the rebirth of the hybrid, the suspension bridge with stay cables. You can see the suspension bridge would be just like this, this thing at the top that you see here. And if you mix it with stay cables, and of course the central part is suspended, just like in a suspension bridge. So you have a suspension bridge with stay cables. This is the hybrid which is taken over, but this is not new. If you see the Brooklyn Bridge, which was made in 1880, span 487 meters, it is of a similar design, which means that it had a cable, it had a suspension bridge cable, and it had stay cables, both of them. So it is not new, but the technique is new. It's a modification of this technique. And here you can see the power of cantilever construction. Practically anything that you see of bridges which are long span are always constructed by cantilever construction because there is no way to support them from the bottom. So you can see the cantilever construction going on for the deck, for example, here. And this is the final one, which is and who's the structural designer? No other than Monsieur Verloger. This is the third Bosphorus Bridge, which is in Turkey. It is already constructed, and it has a span of 1.4 kilometers. And you can see very clearly, it has got a suspension bridge cable, and which is anchored at the ends, and you've got stay cables. So it's a combination of the two, which is much simpler. It is so much more stable. I must tell you something about stay cables. Stay cables are much more stable than suspension bridges as far as wind effects are concerned, because you have got supports at very frequent intervals. Whereas in a suspension bridge, really speaking, the hangers are not providing you any sort of a support in a way. Or as far as wind effects are concerned, it can hold the deck quite nicely. It is good for vertical loads, but nothing for the wind effects, where you get torsions and so many effects. For example, here you have got if you put the stay cables on either side of the deck, you got automatically a great torsional resistance which you are introducing, and very frequent supports at that. So you can see here cantilever construction going on even for this Bosphorus Bridge. This is the the suspension bridge cable. You can see that. And of course, these days, I must say that the pylons are almost always made in concrete. They have found that concrete is a much better material to use for the pylons as compared to steel. And so it's really a mixed type of a construction, that you have concrete, you have steel, you have stay cable construction, you have got suspension bridge cables. So this is what is happening at the moment. Okay, thank you very much for your kind attention, and I hope that we can shake hands like this as is shown very soon again. But at the moment, all I can say is Jai Hind. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. It was an excellent session, and how important construction technology is in deciding the design of the bridge, and how wonderful case studies you have taken on so many types of bridge constructions. I heartily thank you, Professor Tandon, for this excellent lecture. I also thank all the active participants who have come on live. I thank very much Ms. Priya from Digital India for this enhanced capacity experience. And as I see some of the participants putting the interest in the what kind of application we should use, Google Meet and this and that. I think, yes, we are trying always in every webinar to improve the experience. And so we will keep on trying. There are just general non-topic questions that I want to just quickly answer, because there are so many recurring questions. One is, we have not issued any certificates. This is supposed to be a knowledge sharing session. However, since many of you, maybe student body, has an interest for the certification in this kind of webinar, you may please request separately, and we'll see on demand, and also we'll check the participation, and we will see if we can issue only for this webinar. In the past, we have never issued. So yes, please, there is no point in requesting. And secondly, we don't have a separate feedback form. We have always got very good experts so far. And we are quite lucky, and there is no feedback form. However, we are very open to the feedback for improvement, as well as appreciation, as well as thanks. And you may please email your feedback. I am also very grateful to some very positive active participants like Mr. Anand Pargi, who has shared a resource of the report on the Trans-Himalayan explorations for the case of Mr. Everest that sir quoted, and also Mr. Arvind Saleja, who has shared that Wi-Fi Chen is the author of many handbooks of structural engineering, bridge engineering handbook, and that is also good literature. Now I will go to the questions that are being posed by the participants of technical value, and I request Professor Tandon to maybe address them. First question is from Mr. Manish Mehta. I have seen in many metro bridges that they use span made of steel for curve portion along the alignment and rest of the span of concrete. What is the significance to change the material for curve alignments?
I think as far as on a curved alignment, you have to use, as a matter of fact, if you remember the slide I showed you about the Ernakulam bridge, there also we have a curved alignment. I will just put it so that you can have a look at it again. You have to it's not okay. Are you able to see this right hand bottom slide? This right-hand bottom slide,
yes.
This is also a curved bridge. And the what you have to do is that in this case you have girders which are curved. The main job is how to make the fabrication of a girder which is curved. It is very simple. The web of the girder, this is the web of the girder incidentally, you first make that curved and then you weld to it the top and bottom flanges and you weld to it the stiffeners. So you can make a curved bridge made from girders which are not straight but curved. Of course you have to have diaphragms etc, but even simple straight girders also have diaphragms and things like that. So this is one way to do it. A box girder is another way, but somehow in India a steel box girder which is curved has not yet I have seen. I don't know whether Alok has seen anywhere a curved box girder yet in steel, but yes, in concrete there are plenty.
Yeah, we have not seen it as yet. And only let me just share that just 2 days ago we had this IRC committee meeting of B5, that is Steel Bridge Code Committee meeting, where we discussed about the curved box girder bridges. And in fact, there are very scarce international resource also on curved box girder bridges. So we are soon coming out with a guideline for box steel box girder bridges, but that will be only for straight. Thank you.
Okay. Oh, that will be only for straight.
Straight, yeah, because for curved.
Anyway, it's a good start.
Yeah.
So,
are you able to understand how the curved bridges you can make in steel?
I have understood.
Okay, very good.
Sir, then there are a few more questions. So there are two questions from Mr. A. Giri Suburathinam. First is, will India also transport the flyover parts on the constructed track instead of on the city roads? And how does the pushing technique work? What does it mean to push it into position?
So there are two questions. The first question is, whether we will be able to transport the segments over the already constructed bridge and not on the roads. That was the first question, I think.
Yes, sir.
I think that it all depends on the public perception. The moment they feel that this is something that they don't like and they make enough noise about it, people will have to make it. And as a matter of fact, many bridges, even in India, have been constructed using the already constructed portion to transport the new segments. It is not something new even in India, but the issue is the transportation segment. When you this is called an end-on kind of a end-on situation. That means that where you started the bridge from there itself you can keep on bringing the segments on trailer on the already constructed portion and keep going forward. The problem comes how to reverse the transportation equipment. Now I wish there was one animation which I wanted to show you, but animations don't work here. So what they have done basically is that it is a double-headed cart. That means that you have a cart which is supporting the segment. It has got two prime movers, one at the front and one at the back. So you use the front one when you are going forward, and then the same driver can shift to the rear prime mover and take it backward. This is a type of equipment which is already available, but I have not seen it in India, but we have certainly seen it in other countries. In Malaysia, as a matter of fact, where we made one of these bridges, there it was used. So I think that one day or the other, this will have to be done. People don't like any of their routine life disturbed in any way. And certainly traffic is one of the major issues which they are concerned about. So this is something with the future. The next question is about...
Sir, the second question is, how does the pushing technique work? And what does it mean to push it into position?
Yeah. So you see, if you recall the slide that we saw as pushing, I think it must be somebody. Yeah, this one. Okay, this is not the slide I want to show you. You can see, okay, here you can see. You see, on the, in this shed is covered. It better to use a covered shed because so that you don't have, it is easy to work underneath because you are going to construct half a span at a time and then pre-stress it and attach it at the rear. We are not attaching anything in the front. We are attaching at the rear. And then you've got heavy duty jacks, maybe 1,000 ton capacity. And you require at least two to be so that the force that you are pushing or pulling, this can be pulled also incidentally, not only pushed. So pushing is the technique they call it. They also call it incremental launching. So it's we can push it or pull it with jacks which are located at this point only. And this whole thing moves forward. There is friction which is developed at all the piers which you are going to cross. And the friction will keep on increasing, which means that the pushing force or the pulling force will keep on increasing as the length of this bridge keeps on increasing. So what you have to do is to design it for the jacks have to be designed for the final friction force, which is usually 3 to 5%, which you will have to overcome while you are pushing the or pulling the structure from one end to the other. And of course, there are always guides, which you can see perhaps even here. There are guides so that this thing doesn't go by itself in some other direction, but is it's moving in the direction that you want.
Okay. So then there is also an elite question. Please enlighten about pre-stressed steel bridges, where they are constructed. Pre-stressed steel bridges.
Pre-stressed steel.
Yes.
Yes, pre-stressed steel bridges. I think we have, even in India, some people have constructed on border roads. The if you see a typical steel truss, and I think it is done more in trusses than anything else. Let us say you have some kind of a truss, which I wish I could. Okay. So, of course, this is a little different, but if you have a truss, any kind of truss, no, I think let us not confuse it with an arch. There must be some, okay. Yeah, okay. Now, let us say this is a straight steel truss. The bottom will be in tension, and that is where you require the pre-stressing. You don't require pre-stressing in the top. I'm saying if it is simply supported, which most of the steel trusses would be, then if you have a hollow section of the bottom cord, the hollow section can be either built up or rolled section, whichever way. But that is where you put the pre-stressing cable, and at the ends you have make arrangements for the anchorages and pre-stress it. And of course, you should pre-stress it when there is a reasonable amount of load that has already been mobilized on the truss, which means this entire dead load, maybe part of the live load, part of the concrete deck, if that is what the deck is made of, and then only pre-stress it so that you don't start getting tensions at the top. So that is where pre-stressed trusses are used. And like I said, the Border Roads has made a couple of them, if I remember correctly, in India itself.
Okay. So, and then there is one question. So previous question was by Dr. Sharma, and now there is another question by Pratik Diogekar. In the steel arched bridge, where the tubes are filled with concrete, do the reinforcement is also provided?
Well, the reinforcement, I would say, it is not necessary to provide, because if you really see this, it would be so difficult to provide reinforcement in this, unless you put the reinforcement in the beginning, and what is the use of the reinforcement? It is only to take care of shrinkage particularly of concrete, which may happen. But if you are making use of the tube itself or the hollow section itself, which is in steel, as a kind of a reinforcement, and you know, an arch is always under compression. In this case, you will definitely not require any reinforcement, and there will also creep happening, which means that the shrinkage is going to reduce. You can use shrinkage compensating concrete. There are many solutions, but it is not necessary to use reinforcement in this. You should put the reinforcement is the steel tube in which you are filling up the concrete. So the beauty is how they fill the concrete, and they have got a number of levels at which you put the concrete, so that the capacity of the pump required is not too great, and you can keep on doing this. So this is how you do the concrete filled tubes. It's not necessary to put reinforcement, at least in arch bridges.
Okay, I see.
I think even in normal bridges, I doubt if it will be required, because the steel tube that you have to make use of that.
Mr. Chitharth is asking if external pre-stressing is used.
If extra dose, you see, extra dose bridges is a different category by itself. I mean, extra dose bridges are basically things which we use, which are somewhere in between when the bridge is, the span is not too large. For example, if you have this is a slide which shows you something about the extra dose bridge. Extra dose bridge means that when you have spans which are not too large, up to about, this is the current situation. Of course, we have made much bigger cantilever bridges, but this is the free cantilever bridge. You can make it up to a certain span length. If the world record may be 300 meters, but we are not talking about what is the world record. The current state of the art says that after you cross 100 meters, you should think of some other solution. And in this case, you think of an extra dose bridge, at least between 100 and 200 or 225, 230 meters. You may, this is not sacrosanct limits that one is talking about, but the order of the span, once you are in this range of spans, then you can think of an extra dose bridge. Now, what is an extra dose bridge? It is nothing but a cable stayed bridge, except that the pylon is of a smaller, much smaller height. And the other great thing about extra dose bridges, incidentally, there are a number of extra dose bridges in India which have already been constructed and which are being constructed and which are under design. So India may soon become the epicenter of extra dose bridges the way it is going. But the advantage of this extra dose bridge is, and of course, as you can see, it is the stay cables are not as uniformly distributed as you would have in a stay cable. Here you've got some 20% of the length of the length of the main span, which you are utilizing for this. So here you have got a stay cable action, just like what you have here, and you have a cantilever bridge action, which means what you are seeing here. So maybe about 20-30% of the live load is all that is taken by the stay cables. The rest of it goes as a bending moment in the superstructure. So the extra dose bridges, you require pre-stressing here, just as you require pre-stressing in cantilever bridges, and it is made by cantilever construction, just like a cantilever construction. But once you reach a certain stage, then you start putting these stay cables, and that is how the whole thing is made. So extra dose bridges are fascinating. It's the right solution for a certain range of spans. After that, you have to switch over to cable stayed bridges, and as you can see, it has got many more cables as compared to this, and they are at a much longer spacing as you see here. So it's okay. That is how what the extra dosed bridge is. So you require pre-stressing, yes, for right, extra dosed bridges.
Yeah. Now there are two questions for particular technology. So one, Mr. Mallikarjuna is asking about explanation on spliced girder method for long continuous span girders. And Mr. Gauri Shankar is asking on the stress ribbon bridge. So one is the spliced girder method.
Yes, spliced girder is nothing, but if you have a simple bridge, like I was telling you, in that was a photograph taken from the this one. So it is on the Delhi Gurgaon expressway. You must have seen these bridges on the way to the airport, especially the international airport. If you take not the domestic route but the Gurgaon route. And of course, if you are going to Gurgaon, you are invariably going on over it. Now, this, for example, had a joint here. So it was in this case, this is cast in situ in two parts, in precast in two parts, and you leave a joint in between and a gap which you concrete in situ. There are many places where this cast in situ joint has been done away with. We have done places where it's done even in five pieces, for example, a beam. And of course, you have to support temporarily the joints. And either you have to have a cast in situ joint there, or you have a shear key joint like you have seen in box girders. But in a beam like this, it is much safer to provide some lateral stability, because when you pre-stress, and if the alignment is not exact, you can see what will happen. It will just go off. The pre-stressing may not will follow the center line, but you can have a problem if your alignment is not perfect. So I would say, if you are doing a box girder, it is much simpler to do splicing of the either the girder itself or segmental in segments. It is much simpler. But the moment you get to these beams, then I think a cast in situ joint is much better, and you should put a diaphragm at the same place so that before you pre-stress, you have a really intact structure which has got no chance of moving this way or that way when you pre-stress.
Okay. There is one particular question based on case. Dr. Binod Singh wants to know that there is a temporary cable structure in the construction of CFST railway arch bridge. So are we going to remove them? That's what he is asking.
I don't know which arch bridge is, but normally in arches is like I have explained that the way to construct it. This is, for example, the Rajahmundry bridge, which is also for the railways. The arch itself is constructed by having this tower and stay cables. As you keep on growing this cantilever, you have to keep on adding stay cables to it. And these are all of temporary nature. Of course, this arch bridge is a bowstring arch, which means that there will be a deck which will be constructed here so that the all the arches are made independent. So, which particular arch bridge you are talking about, I don't know, but generally all arch bridges now, if it is a recent bridge, then this is how it will be constructed. And all the temporary works, which means these steel towers and the stay cables will be no longer of use after you have already constructed the bridge.
I see. So then there is one case about the Ernakulam area, and that two separate questions relating to, I think, same case. So Mr. Kiran and Mr. Ramarjun are asking this. One is, for after construction, how to remove the steel girder? So this is there is a curved steel girder at Ernakulam Bridge. That is what is mentioned.
You don't have to remove this steel girder. This is a permanent part of the structure.
I see.
Steel bridge is a continuation. If you see the end of this the cantilever construction, which is a concrete bridge, after that there is a curved span here. Because you can see that this is a straight line which is coming here, up to here. But this has to be joined and it has to be tangential to when you meet here. So this span is a curved bridge. So this is a permanent part of the structure. It is not temporary.
Right.
Here you can see this is the permanent part.
Hmm.
Only it is a lot of circus acts have to be done here. You got to fly over here. And this will hang over the flyover. You have got a pier which is just hugging in the flyover, which means that when you come to the foundations have to be eccentric. So you will have an L-shaped foundation, and to make that and to make it stable is always a tricky kind of a situation. There's a lot of engineering problems. But this itself, if we are talking about, it is a permanent part of the structure. It is not to be removed.
I see. And so I think the related is in Kochi Metro, Ernakulam, they have used U-girder and I-girder for construction. So what are the factors to be considered to choose which type of girders to use?
You see, when you have a viaduct, there are several options available. The options are that you can have, for example, girder slab bridge, which you have seen, what you saw in this the Delhi-Gurgaon expressway example. You can have a box girder bridge where you use a segmental construction, or you can have a U-girder. Now, in recent times, U-girders have been favored because it can be done much faster. A U-girder is a full U-girder. That means one full span of, let us say, 28 meters, which I believe is the maximum span we have gone so far. This whole U-girder, you have to, of course, be able to transport this 28-meter span. It is straight normally, and this 28-meter span is transported, is precast, pre-tensioned, taken to the site and erected by two cranes, just like we do any other long beam girder or something, which you saw the two cranes lifting it up. So this is how it is done. There are no joints, so you save a lot of time in the joining process, which means this all these joints that you have to first dry match, then put epoxy and then do temporary pre-stressing. There are a lot of methods, a lot of intermediary steps that has to be done before you can get to this. All that is saved because you've got just one single piece to be spanned between pier and pier. But obviously you can do it for not a very long span, but 28 meters, yes. That is the longest span, I think, that has been constructed in India for a U-girder. And there you have one U-girder for each track. Whereas in a box girder, you are constructing both the tracks on the same box girder. So there is a difference between the two. In structurally completely different, but like I said, people have still found that the U girder is the fastest way to construct the metro. So if you are looking at speed U girders, but there are many places where they have not opted for the U girder. One good example is the NCRTC, the rapid rail, which we know about. The work is under construction between Delhi and Meerut. They have preferred the box girder solution, just like this precast segmental. Of course, there are other issues with the U girder, at least for engineers, because the U girder has got no torsional rigidity. So it is something which is slightly flimsy in that sense, that if you have some kind of a major event, for example, if there is a terrorist attack, I'm just giving you an example, I doubt if the U girder will survive, but the box girder, there is a good chance it will survive because it is covered from all the sides. Unless you put the, let us say, your device in the inside the box girder, then of course it's even then it may survive. But a U girder in that way, it's not as robust, I would say. I will not call it flimsy. I'll say U girder is not as robust as a box girder. So it's depends. If you want speed of construction, you should go in for a U girder, and then there will be two U girders, one for each track, and it will be simply supported between the girders. But when you have a continuous span or something like that, then you have to come back to a box girder of something of this nature.
So now we come to the last two questions. Mr. Chitarth wants to know the about the seismic resistance measures for bridges. And maybe before that, Mr. Rehmat Akbar and Ms. Elizabeth want to know the basic design steps. So these are allied.
Okay, as far as seismic resistance is concerned, you see a very good example here. As you can see, the bearings have been removed. Bearings have been eliminated, not removed, eliminated here. There is it's a monolithic construction between the pier and the superstructure. This is a much more seismic resistant as compared to if there was a bearing here. But obviously, you cannot make it very large because there are movements which you have to cater to because of shrinkage, creep, temperature. But this double pier that you see here, the same cross section has been divided into two parts so that only half the width is each one is only half the width of what you would have if you required whatever you required for a single single pier. So this, surprisingly, if you just calculate it, it has got only 1/4 the rigidity as compared to a single pier of the total cross section which are represented by these two leaf piers, as we call them. So this permits easy movement due to temperature, shrinkage, creep, etc. And it is much more earthquake resistant because anything that is of a portal type is seismically more resistant than something which becomes a cantilever. If you have a bearing here, the pier is then a cantilever for seismic forces. The seismic forces act at the deck level or the superstructure level. So the substructure or the pier will act like a cantilever, and the cantilever is the worst thing you can have in a seismic in seismic structures. So I don't say it is the worst, but I'd say it is the least preferred. If you can somehow make it monolithic, like it has been done in this case, then it will be seismically more resistant, because portals have many more points where seismic hinges or can be provided, or ductility can be provided so that seismic hinges can be taken care of. So ductility, all the portals always have are always more resistant seismically as compared to simple cantilever piers with bearings. So there are other ways. We are talking about putting seismic resistant devices at the bottom, just like in buildings. A few buildings have been made the same way, bridges, at this is the point where normally the seismic isolation is taken place, which means that you isolate the movement of the superstructure from the substructure by putting a sliding mechanism here. Then the seismic forces that will be transferred will be only what is transmitted from the bearings. So if you have a sliding bearing, or it will certainly give you much less, only what is transmitted by friction, or if you have an elastomeric bearing, then whatever is transmitted by the elastomer deformation, only those type of forces would be transmitted to the substructure. You see, in the difference between buildings and bridges is, in buildings we are trying to save what is above the foundations. In bridges, what we are trying to design basically for seismic is the piers and the foundations. We don't have to design the superstructure much for the seismic. Seismic effects are minimal in the superstructure, but they are basically in the substructure and foundations, because the force that is acting is somewhere here, the horizontal force, and that has to be transferred by the substructure to the foundations, and then from the foundations to the ground. So there is a big difference between how you provide seismic devices in a bridge and in a building. In a building, you will provide it at the bottom of the foundation. Here, you will provide it at the bottom of the superstructure. Okay, so that is about seismic resistance. Yeah.
And now the last question, maybe if you can take one. Mr. Rehmat Ali and Miss Elizabeth want to just know the summary of the design steps of a bridge.
Summary of the designs. Well, I strongly recommend that you please have a look at so many codes that have been produced, handouts that have been made. For example, our bridge code is very similar to the Euro code. And our code, as well as the Euro code, has explanatory handbooks which tell you how, what are the steps that you have to take in the design. And I strongly recommend that you should see those if you are at the stages of learning how to do the design of a bridge and various types of bridges. We have got special publications of externally pre-stressing girder slab bridges. We have got segmental bridges. There are many special publications which have been made by IRC on the subject of concrete bridges, and more are on the way.
Thank you very much, sir. I think we have to call it a day. Me and all the participants, we really are grateful for your session, and maybe Alok sir can offer a small thank you note.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that once again you have delivered a very fascinating lecture, sir. As always, it is always a privilege and pleasure to listen to you, and I'm sure the participants are hugely benefited, and I think your lectures are always very motivating. You know, it motivates people to come to the profession, and I think we need to hear more. We ye dil mange more. With that, I thank you once again, And I thank all the participants. And I think we look forward to many such lectures. I think ISTRACT is doing a great job in organizing such lectures. And we will continue to do that. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I think it's been since 2 hours you are speaking continuously. I haven't seen a speaker who has been speaking continuously for about 2 hours without any interruption.
Yes.
It shows your passion for the subject.
Yes.
No, but I have a bottle of water here.
Yeah, even though you have spoken for about 2 hours uninterrupted.
Yes.
Hats off to you, sir. At this age, we need to learn a lot from you.
No. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Alok. And thank you, Dr. Anil Sheth. And thank you for the organizers of this
Priya,
new Zoom.
Thanks, Priya, for helping us. And
so we need to say thank to you.
Thank you to the participants.
Yeah.
You can deliver a lecture only if there is somebody to listen.
Yes. need to be a speaker who can speak for 2 hours continuously also.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you very much.
So we are closing the session. Participants, if they have any feedback questions or certificate questions or any other unanswered questions, you may please email to istructi@gmail.com. Thank you. I'm closing.